Right, thank you very much, Rosie, for reading that. And can I add my welcome to Ben's? My name is Jonty. So I'm just got this translation app here which needs to keep working. My name is Jonty, and it's my privilege to bring you God's word this evening. Too many phones. Right, here we go. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you're real, and that you're here by your Spirit, and that you've got a word from your Son for each and every one of us this evening. Pray that you give us ears to hear and eyes to see what you are doing and what you have done amongst us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Is this it? That was the strapline for one of the big alpha campaigns over the years. I don't know if you've seen kind of posters like this around. They've spent millions on posters, particularly in big cities like London, Manchester, and maybe Southampton. But this particular ad and that particular line just stuck in my mind. I wonder whether that small, simple question, is this it? I wonder whether it just resonates with so many people. But there's so many people just look at their lives and who they are, who they've become, and think to themselves at some level, at some point, think to themselves, is this it? Experience that kind of frustration, that sense of dissatisfaction with who they are, boredom at their life. Is this it? Maybe you're here and you're not a Christian. Lovely to have you with us. We have many who are just thinking about the faith, just looking in on the faith week by week. Isn't that something of the reason why you're here? Presumably at some level, you think there must be more to life than meets the eye. It's a great question to ask. Is this it? And we believe that the answer is yes, there is more to life. Yes, this doesn't have to be it. We think that there are great answers found in the person of Jesus. And I guess that's what Alpha were trying to do. They're trying to scratch that itch. There is more to life, particularly for those who don't know Jesus. But here's the thing. I think that's a question that Christians still ask and Christians still wrestle with. Is this it? Yes, we have Jesus. Yes, we have answers. Yes, we have the Spirit. Yes, we have the Bible. And yet, those things are satisfying. And they're true, and yet Christian, that's most of us here. Do you ever find yourself at some level, at some point, asking, is this it? Ever find yourself frustrated, dissatisfied? Dare I even say it, bored in the Christian life? I kind of hope that you do. I kind of hope you do have some kind of godly discontentment with your Christian life as it is at the moment. I hope that there's desire, appetite, hunger, ambition for more. Christian, is there a sense in which you're not happy with where you are at the moment? You long to know God better. You long to have a deeper conviction of the reality and the goodness and the greatness of God. You long for a sense of progress. Goodness, I'm not the person I once was, but I'm not the person I want to be. Do you identify with that at all? Do you long to have mastery over your past, over your fears, over your interactions with people, over your sin? I hope you do. I kind of hope in some way you look at your life and say, is this it? Isn't there more, God? Isn't there more you want to do with me? But here's the thing. Dissatisfaction can be absolute rocket fuel for the Christian life. It can really help, but it can also be poison. It can be the key to progress. It can bring a new life and a new energy to the Christian walk. But it also can be deadly. And I think there are not many places in the Bible where we see this most clearly or more clearly than the book of Colossians. We're spending about 14 weeks in the book of Colossians. It's a wonderful little letter. It's got a lot to say, but for now, just know this. as we get into this letter, Paul's going to spell out for us and for anyone who reads this that there is a kind of right and a wrong kind of spiritual dissatisfaction. And there are right and wrong ways to process that dissatisfaction. We're going to see why it is that dissatisfaction can be rocket fuel for the Christian life, really helpful, but also it can be deadly. And as Paul starts this letter, right up front, he teaches this little church that he's never actually visited. He teaches them that one of the keys, one of the key principles, one of the key things that distinguish between healthy and unhealthy dissatisfaction is thankfulness. Paul teaches us the importance of thankfulness. Tonight, Paul's going to show us that every Christian can and should be thankful, as Paul is thankful in these couple of verses, for one reason only, and that's because to be a Christian and to remain a Christian is no small thing. What are there? 120 of us here? That there are 120 people here for no other reason but for your shared interest in this dead guy called Jesus is no small thing. It's a miracle. And I've summed it up like this. We should be thankful because of our supernatural response to a supernatural gospel word. And we're just going to look at those two kind of parts of that sentence this evening. Firstly, our supernatural response. So look down. We're in verse 3. After his kind of usual greetings of verse 1 and verse 2, he says, we, as in Paul and Timothy, we pray for you. And we thank God for you because we've been told three things, three marks of genuine New Testament Christianity. I wonder if you see it then in verses 4 and 5. Three marks. We're told about their verse 4, faith. Verse 4, their love and their hope. Faith, hope, and love. Three things which are worthy of thanks to God because all three are unnatural. All three are unnormal. When was the last time we thought about it? Let's take the first one, faith. What is Paul saying? These Christians in the first century, they were once pagans, but now they're Christians. They're trusting in, leaning on, depending on, they're in reliance of this man. Yes, a God-man, but a man. This man, Jesus of Nazareth, who they believe to be the Christ. For Paul, that's not an ordinary thing. That's remarkable. It's weird. It's weird for them, and it's weird for us. Think about it. You've never met him. You've never seen him. You don't even properly understand his backstory. You're not Jewish. All that he is and all that he's done is rooted in the Jewish scriptures. You don't properly understand it, although we're kind of making efforts to. And back then for the Colossians, well, they haven't had 2,000 years of church history. There weren't churches in every town. The empire was starting to get frosty towards Christians. And the Jewish people didn't like Christians particularly. It wasn't an easy thing to do. And yet, he says, verse 4, we have heard of your faith in Jesus the Messiah. For Paul, that's a cause for prayer and for thanks and for joy. This isn't normal. I love the way one writer puts it, thinking about why there's so many reasons for us not to believe in Jesus. He says this, Jesus was born in a tiny, irrelevant town in the Roman Empire and raised in another small village. He had to walk from one place to the next. As an adult, he was never traveled more than 200 miles from the town where he was born. He had none of the resources people use today to make an impact, no social media platform, no podcast audience, no clever videos, no website. He didn't have the resources people used in the first century to make an impact. He never held political office, never ruled a nation, never led an army, never authored a book. His family was insignificant. Locals suspected he was an illegitimate son. His mother was a poor peasant woman. His father couldn't afford much. Jesus didn't receive an education, never married, never had children, never owned a home of his own, didn't possess more than his clothes on his back. As an adult, his own brother was suspicious of his ministry, a work that ended after just three short years. Public opinion turned on him. Most of his followers abandoned him. One disciple betrayed him, another denied him. He was rejected by the religious, hunted by the powerful, mocked and unjustly persecuted by his enemies. He suffered an unfair trial, was publicly humiliated, brutally beaten, unduly executed in the most horrific way. Even then, the few followers who remained had to borrow a grave to bury him. In so many ways, he was pathetic. And yet, there are 120 of us here. 120 of us, most of whom, something just rings true. You never met him. There's something strange and yet compelling about him. There's something which draws us to him as we read the accounts of his life. And so we have faith in Jesus the Messiah. Secondly, love for Christians. Again, Paul thanks God because this isn't natural. Again, I came across a writer reflecting on how hard it must be for a teenager coming to church week by week. And he said this, their friends get to stay in bed, play games, enjoy sports, go shopping, watch YouTube, and so much more. Church attending children get up early to go to a service, sing songs and hymns, sit through a lesson, hear about events that happened thousands of years ago, drink over-diluted orange squash, not at Christchurch. Can you imagine serving church to your school friends the next day? Most adults in church have grown so used to what we do that they don't realise how weird church is for the vast majority of people in our country, even more so for children and young people. Get the point? This is weird. You're weird. Think about it for a moment. The average person here, think about the average member here. The amount of time and energy, social energy, commitment, thought, prayer, money, effort that goes into this community of people. Some of whom you get on really well with and others, well, less naturally. And yet, you're here. And you want to be here. I want to be a part of your life and you want to be a part of my life. I care for you. You care for me. We rejoice when another rejoices. We weep when another weeps. We have love for all of God's people. Faith, hope, and love. Interestingly, the reason for the faith and the reason for the love is hope. The Christian life is all about hope. Hope, from hope in heaven, verse 5. The faith and love that spring from the hope stored up for you in heaven. What is it that ultimately prompts a person to trust Jesus and join this community? What's the message of Christianity about? What's the purpose? What's the goal? What's the reason why we're always, to some degree, going to be left unsatisfied? Because the Christian message is one about hope. It's about the future. That is weird. A Christian has been persuaded to put all their eggs in an unseen heavenly basket. All their eggs in a world beyond death, a promise for the fullness of time, a salvation to come, a glory to come, a victory to come. It's described, verse 5, as being stored up for us, like the ultimate Christmas present, which is just wrapped and put in the cupboard, and one day will be given for us. It's like kind of waiting for some kind of trust fund. One day it will be ours, but not yet. That's what we're waiting for. That's what we're living for. That's what we're hoping for, longing for. Why? Well, because we've been touched by the supernatural God of the Bible. And it is a supernatural response. That's why verse 3, he thanks God and praises God and not them, because it's God's work in them, not their work. And that's why verse 6, he highlights that the gospel came to them because of Epaphras. It was God who sent Epaphras to them. It's God's work in their lives. That's why verse 8, he says, the love that they have came from the Spirit, and presumably the faith and the hope as well came from the Spirit. What's happened is unnatural, a supernatural work of God in their lives, one for which we should be grateful, one for which they should be grateful, one for which Paul was grateful. And yet it's so easy not to be grateful. So easy to look around and see what you don't have. Maybe you come into a room like this and you see so many people look so sorted, so capable, so knowledgeable, so wise. You look in the mirror spiritually and you see what God hasn't done in your life. You see your own spiritual shortcomings, mistakes, failures, your weaknesses. Maybe over time you have that kind of that new phone experience. I don't know if you know what I mean, or I don't know what it is for you, kind of new trainer experience, a new handbag, or new kind of game experience. When you first get it, this is the business. You tell everyone about it, you spend loads of time kind of working out or enjoying it or sharing it with others. But look, weeks go by, months go by, years go by, some of us decades go by, and the sheen just wears off. Yep, Jesus died for my sin. Yeah, I'm a Christian, but it's very easy to have small thoughts about what we have in Christ, small thoughts about who you are spiritually, small thoughts about what God has done in your life. Well, tonight I just want to urge you to resist that. We'll see more of this in the coming weeks, but we see it already here, right at the beginning of this letter. If at some point you heard the promise of the gospel, if at some point you responded to the death and resurrection of Jesus, you put your life and death in his hand, if at some point you found that Jesus draws you to himself like a magnet, and as he draws you to him, he at the same time draws you to others who are also drawn to him. Paul says you have the biggest reason for confidence and for assurance. You have the biggest reason to praise him and to thank him, because God has supernaturally worked in you that you might respond to him in faith and hope and love. Second thing, more briefly, the thing you have responded to is the life-giving gospel word. You've responded to a supernatural gospel word, looking at verses 6 to 8. We're not quite sure what's going on in this little town called Colossae, but it seems that they've been told a message they've been told that the message that they've heard wasn't quite right. Someone's undermining the work that Epaphras had done amongst them. Even then, this was probably written about AD 60. It's probably written while Paul was in prison, as we see at the end of the book of Acts. Only 30 years after Jesus' death. But even then, there were different gospels floating around. And someone was saying, the gospel you've got isn't quite right. How much more is it the case 2,000 years later that there are different gospels floating around? How do you know which one to believe? How do you know which one is true? God's gospel. So we've got the Catholic gospel. Jesus wants you to be good. We've got the prosperity gospel. Jesus wants you to be rich. The liberal gospel. Jesus wants you to be true to yourself. The therapeutic gospel. Jesus just wants you to be happy. And they go on and on, and they all sound good, and they all got a grain of truth. But how do you know which one is the real message? How do you know which one is the true message of the gospel, as he puts it in verse 5? Well, there's two things which will mark the authentic gospel. Two things Paul highlights: how it's spread and where it's come from, the fruit of this gospel and the root of this gospel. Firstly, its fruit. This is a powerful gospel, we're told in verses 5 and 6. Paul says this. Let me go from verse 5. The faith and love that spring from the hope stored up for you in heaven, and about which you've already heard in the true message of the gospel that has come to you. In the same way, the gospel is bearing fruit and growing throughout the world, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and truly understood God's grace. This gospel that you heard is the same gospel out there. The gospel seed planted in your heart is the same seed that spread it all around the world. You haven't got some dodgy spin-off. You haven't got some kind of fake or some fraud. And you can tell because it's producing the same fruit. This gospel is changing your lives and changing the whole Roman Empire. It's changing the world. It's cleansing consciences. It's giving you new desires, giving you purpose and vision. It's restoring relationships, friendships, marriages, communities. This gospel is bearing fruit. Do you know there's only one other place in the Bible where these words, bearing fruit and growing, are put together? Genesis chapter 1. Adam and Eve were told to be fruitful and multiply. It's like Paul was saying, kind of what Adam and Eve were told to do physically, fill the world with people. God is doing spiritually with new people, new creation people, as he is in Colossae, as people are understanding the grace of God in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's bearing fruit. This is a powerful gospel that changes lives. That's what real life is all about. More than that, though, it's an apostolic gospel. Verse 4, you learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf, and he told us of your love in the Spirit. The roots of this message are in God's hand-picked, trained ambassadors. I can imagine that the fact that they learnt it from Epaphras, maybe it troubled them. Who is this guy? How can we trust him? Feels a little second-hand. How can I know that he's got it right? All of this grace stuff, it sounds too good to be true. I mean, it's a good question to ask yourself. How do you know what the church you grew up in, if you grew up in the church, how do you know that what they taught you is right? How do you know that favorite Christian book that you're reading is right? Just because it's in the Christian department of Waterstones or whatever doesn't mean it's particularly helpful. How do you know that the podcast that you love listening to, how do you know that that's helpful? How do you know that the stance of some major denominational leader, how do you know that what they're saying is right? Maybe slightly closer to home. How do you know that this church is a safe church for you to be in? How do you know that what we're saying, what I say, is right? Well, Paul says you can look at what it produces. Does it change people's lives, make them more like Christ? Good question. Secondly, what's the root? Where's it coming from? Where's the authority? Where is this teaching from? Paul says there's only one test. And get this, it's not popularity. It's not whether people love it or not. It's not even whether it feels good or how many PhDs the person who told it to you has. There's only one real test, which is this. How does it relate to what the apostles taught? You learned from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, he's a faithful minister on Christ on our behalf. What he says is matches with what we say, and what we say comes straight from God. Does it mesh with what the apostles say? Does it major on what the apostles major on, minor on what they minor on? Does it affirm what they affirm, deny what they deny? Does it treat the apostolic perspectives and patterns and prescriptions as the very words of God? What the Colossians heard, well, it was exactly what Paul was teaching. Epaphras is a fellow servant, a faithful minister, and so they can take heart that whatever else is going on in their lives, and whatever else is going on in your life as you sit here this evening, Paul is wanting them and us to remember that if this apostolic gospel has come to you, and you've truly understood it as they had, and you've responded in hope, which has produced faith and produced love, whatever else is happening in your life, you have reasons, and you will always have reasons to be confident and to be assured and to sing praises to your God and to be thankful to him, because what has happened to you is not normal and it's not natural. The truth is, this room is filled with people for whom the almighty triune God of the Bible has supernaturally broken into your life. And to be honest, you will spend the rest of your lives and the rest of eternity trying to unpack what he's done for you in the gospel. Real Christianity is thankful Christianity, Paul says. So as we end, I just want to ask us two questions. And we'll have a bit of time for Q&A, hopefully. The first is this. When did you last look back? I bumped into a guy at Redeemer Church Winchester, actually. And he encouraged me to interview my parents. This is my mum. And this is the interview that I did with her a few weeks ago. My parents came out over in the Windrush generation. And once this guy discovered that, he said it'd be really interesting just to interview them, capture their story. It's the kind of thing that you'll kind of forget someday. And so I wanted to just interview them. Nothing long, just four questions. Have it on video, you can show your grandchildren. I thought it's a really good idea. So I did it last week. It's meant to be 20 minutes. It ended up being an hour and 20 minutes. And really interesting. I think everyone should do it. It doesn't matter where your parents are from. If your parents are around, interview them. Just so you've got a kind of memory of something of their life. And as we went, we got to kind of hour and 10, I said, okay, we probably should stop. One final question. Having looked back, we've just kind of did the Potter history of your life. Having looked back, is there one thing that the Lord has taught you over these years? And I was hoping for some kind of verse or some doctrine. And in a second, she just came up to me. I'm just thankful. I'm just so thankful for all the blessings along the way. And you might think she's talking about kind of her material benefits of being over here and all sorts of different things. What does she mean? She then recaps, she goes back over her life, renaming and recapping the spiritual influences and encouragements and catalysts along the way. The people who pointed her to Jesus and encouraged her in her faith. As she came over here as a young lady. That's just a wonderful thing to be able to do and a wonderful instinct to be able to have. And I want to be able to do that. There's something really helpful and profound, isn't there, when believers are able to look back, spend our lives looking forward to the next thing, the next job, the next task, the next goal, the next relationship, the next project. But when was the last time you looked back? Looked back at those moments, maybe those moments where sin just became a real problem for you. God really convicted you of sin. Maybe moments when the grace of God in the gospel of God shone particularly bright for you. When you decided, maybe happily or reluctantly or for the first time or maybe at a special time, that from this moment on, I want to live for Jesus. Or those moments when the truth or a reality or a perspective from the Bible changed the way that you thought about everything. Or someone just spoke the word of God into your life, into a situation. I don't want to live in the past, but as Christians, we can't forget the past. You see, those moments are worth remembering. Maybe it's at the beginning of the year. Maybe at the beginning of the year, you want to look back and just think, what do I want to thank God for over the past year? Or maybe it's at Lord's Supper. Maybe you're doing that this morning as you thought about Jesus' death. Maybe it's at birthdays, maybe yours or others, or other significant occasions, whenever it is. It's worth remembering those moments, because those moments are significant. Because those are the moments when the eternal God has supernaturally and graciously broken into your life. When was the last time you looked back? And as you look back, we must look up. This week, George Verwer died. Many of you won't have heard of him. He's this guy. He's famous for wearing this outrageous jacket, which has a picture of the globe on it. He started something called Operation Mobilization. Today, OM is involved in over 140 countries sharing the good news of Jesus. And essentially, this guy started it with much help from other people. Tributes have been pouring in, as you can imagine, about George, but one particularly caught my eye. And someone said this, George Verwer was a man who never got over the goodness of the good news. He never got over the goodness of the good news. And as we look up, as we look back and we think about what God has done for us, and then we look up, what do we see? What do we see as we look up? Paul is urging us to see the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. A Father who has been unspeakably good to you and I. A Father who may not have given you the life you wanted, may not have answered your prayers as you've wanted, but the Father has put his Son to death for you and put people in your life that you might hear about his Son and put his Holy Spirit in your heart that you might respond in faith and hope and love. And I hope that you will never get over the goodness of God in the gospel. I hope that, like Paul, you will never stop thanking him for all that he's already done. If you're a Christian here today, if you think that might be you, if you think you might have started to get over the goodness of the God of God in the gospel, well, Colossians should be a good tonic for you, as Paul brings them and us back to all that we have and all that we are in Christ. I'm going to give us a moment just to maybe look back and look up by ourselves, and then we've got a bit of time for Q&A. It's a moment for you to speak to God. Great, let's pause there. We've got time for Q&A. One of the reasons we have Q&A is because I'm not the authority. We believe the apostles are the authority. So I want you to keep me honest. How I explained what they've said. And maybe you've got questions. Maybe I wasn't clear on something. This is your opportunity to ask me any question you want. Ben's going to run around with the mic. I'll give you 1 minute just to chat to a neighbor. Maybe discuss your question. Maybe they can triage your question. Maybe think about ways that you can nurture thankfulness in your life, and we'll come back together in a minute. Great. Good. We've got a few minutes for questions or comments. Maybe you've wrestled with this issue of thankfulness over the years, and there's been particular things that have helped you to nurture thankfulness. It'd be good to hear from you. Maybe you've got questions, maybe comments. Hands up. Otherwise, we'll just sing. Jonathan? Here we go.
Thanks, John T. it is you've talked about thankfulness, and that is, in a sense, talking upwards a lot. But the mode of this sort of encouragement that Paul's giving is directly to other Christians. So he has encouraged them with communication upwards and also towards them. So he's talking about prayer, and he's talking about answers to prayer directly to those people. I guess a couple of questions of, is that an appropriate model for us today? How do we do that well? And how, if it is a good thing to do, do we foster that in our church community?
As in sharing our thankfulness for grace in other people's life.
And sharing about, I think I personally find it quite difficult to know how to say to someone,
I'm praying for you.
I'm praying for you.
Yeah, yeah.
That's is sort of an awkward sentence. It feels a bit strange. And how do we encourage that, I guess, as part of it?
I think there's about five questions there. I'm going to take a few of them. I think that's right. This is strange because he's telling them he's praying for them and thanking God for them. Next week, he's actually going to tell them what he prays for them, kind of prospectively. I think both are particularly helpful for Paul as a teaching lesson. So I think his primary thing is to encourage them that what's happened to them is the real supernatural work of God, which is why I was trying to encourage us with that. But I think also secondarily, it does teach us that it can be encouraging when other people see that in us. And also teaches us to kind of, as we see it in others, thank God ourselves. I think there are those kind of secondary and tertiary applications. And similarly, when you're praying for people, it is an encouragement to know that A, they care, B, kind of God's heard that prayer and he might be working in our lives in that way. But also, sometimes it can help people think about the kind of thing they should be thinking about as they're going through something, maybe. So I'm praying that you would hold on to God. That says to that person, actually, you're trying to encourage them to hold on to God in a way as well. And that's the reason why Paul often shares his prayers for people, that they might know how they should be praying for each other and for themselves, as he's teaching them as the apostle. And how to do that without it being weird, I guess it'll depend on the kind of context. But there are not many people who get, even kind of those who don't know Christ, who are freaked out by you saying, I'm praying for you, even in the abstract. I guess the better you know them, the more specific you want to be. But I think it's encouraging, isn't it, to hear that people are praying for you and to say that to each other. I think that can be really helpful. Thank you, Jonathan. Any other composite questions? Lovely. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing a great hymn, which hopefully is obvious why I've chosen it. One for us just to declare to each other and to a listening world the unnumbered blessings that God has given us in the gospel. Let me just pray for us. Maybe the band wants to come up as I'm praying. Let me pray. Father, we thank you that you're a God of unspeakable grace, grace given to us in your Son, grace given to us in the gospel which has come to us, grace given to us in your Spirit which has given us new life. And we just want to spend a moment just thanking you for the people who told us the gospel, for their love, for their boldness, for their perseverance. We want to spend a moment thanking you for your Son who endured hell that we might have heaven. We want to thank you for your Spirit who gave us new life that we might accept all that he is. And Father, there's so many things in our life which are frustrating and disappointing and not as they ought to be. But we praise you that we do have you. And we do have hope. And we do have new life. Pray that you'll teach us what it means to be thankful. Teach us the unnumbered blessings that we have in Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing.